especially if you'll be racing at home in Olympics. That is a once in a lifetime opportunity.
Well, you can see coming up in just a while the men's Finn medal race. And, well, again, we have the Portland Harbour itself, which was hugely important during the Second World War, protecting the submarines and ships that were in there. And here is the course for the Finn medal race. Come on, Peter Lester, tell us about it.
Well, really a up-down course. So up around that top mark, down to the bottom, through the bottom mark gate. Very similar to what we had for the Star. But then there's the offset reaching leg over to the finish. The Finn, this is what we've all been waiting for. Are we going to see a small piece of history made here? One way or the other, John, it's going to be action-packed with, right now, we have Christensen in the lead. Jonas Christensen from Denmark. But just 2 points behind Ben Ainslie. And Ainslie looking to really make sailing history. If he can get up and win it, he will become the greatest sailing Olympian ever.
Well, that's a tremendous bit of pressure. It's a big bit of pressure, particularly after what we just witnessed. So that, I think that, everything goes according to plan. It should be okay. But I tell you what, Håkon Christensen, when we saw him first earlier in the week, he was sensational with his speed. You mentioned it. You said you can't believe how fast he was.
Well, in the first part of the regatta, when it was blowing, there was a bit of wind around. Christensen, well, he reeled off the first four races, and we thought, my goodness. Obviously, in those conditions, he was fast, he had good speed. But then the late A came, and we short saw the winds moderate. Coupled with that, I suspect Ben Ainslie might have done a bit of a review of his equipment and of himself. In the strong winds, Christensen, he's at 102 kilos. Ben Ainslie measures in at 92, and I think that was playing an effect. So the standings going into the medal race. We've got Denmark, Jonas Høgh Christensen on 26. Ben Ainslie from GBR on 28. Pierre-Jan Postma from Netherlands on 42. Jonathan Lobert on 47. Ivan Kasbak on 47 also. And Zobier on 49. So it's that top group, I think, make up the potential for first, second and third.
How important will it be for Christensen to just make this another race? Because he has, in fact, he's led throughout all 10 previous races. He hasn't faltered. He's been right there. Okay, there's been a little bit of a change after the medal, but the Danes will expect him to win, surely.
Well, John, it's not just another race, first up. It's the Olympic Games and history in the making. And yeah, I'm sure you can say LR3, that's the course. You can say, yeah, it's just another race, but it's not. Quite simply, it's not. As Peter Reggio, has he got the box seat?
Are you envious? Is that
well, he's, look, I'm not surprised that he has got the gong for the medal races. For the Star earlier, now the Finn, because he is absolutely regarded as, you know, top class. He's the best in the business. He did the last America's Cup, and he was certainly under a lot of pump there. And here he is in Weymouth for the medal race of the Finn class. Jonas Høgh Christensen from Denmark leads.
He is, in fact, 31 years old. Everybody's talking about the age of Ben Ainslie at 35, but Christensen has been around the block a little bit. Won the Finn Gold Cup in 2009. He's represented Denmark in the Finn class in 2004, 2008, and of course this year.
There's Ben Ainslie, second on 28 points. 35 years of age. And certainly he really has a huge pressure on his shoulders, big expectation. And if he can win this one, he becomes the greatest Olympian in sailing. I just I keep scouring the crowd because the great Dane. There's a whole lot of little side stories here. Paul Elvstrom is regarded in Olympic sailing as the greatest sailor that's ever been. If Ben Ainslie wins, he'll become the greatest sailor, Paul Elfman. I'll be looking in the crowd to see if he's actually there. But coupled with that, the person that could stop Ainsley achieving that monumental goal is actually also a Dane, with Jonas Høgh Christensen.
Did you know that Denmark actually, in terms of their overall performances at Olympic Games, they have got and sailing firmly at the top of their achievements. They, of all the medals they've ever won in the Olympic Games, sailing accounts for twice as many as the next one. So it's sailing at 12 gold medals overall, I'm talking about all the modern Olympics. Cycling with six, rowing with six. So sailing has become the most important sport in Denmark as far as success is concerned.
Warning signal for the Finn class. It's the medal race. How is this one going to play out? The top mark set, at, that's 2.05, that's the wind direction, and the clock's running. And we're on the windward leeward course, three laps.
There is another lovely little intriguing moment here as well, because Postma was involved in that little incident. It wasn't so little at the time, in December 2011 in Perth, and Ben Ainsley lost his rag, and he's normally quite, you know, a gentleman, and certainly definitely shocked spectators when he jumped in the water and threatened a media boat. But I must say that on that occasion, Postma came through and actually won that particular event. He's now in bronze medal position at the moment. So there's a lot of history around all these guys at the top of the tree.
Oh, there certainly is. The other factor I think it's worth just throwing on the into the discussion is the Finn class, again, a bit like the Star, they can the boats are very tightly regulated as we look at the weather. It's 16 degrees, the wind southwest. It's up a little bit, 19.5 degrees. That's the best part of fighting. But John, going into the regatta, all the Finns go with two masts, two sails. Then over the series of races, not so much the mast, but the sails actually deteriorate. So the shape of the sail, especially in strong winds, will in fact deteriorate or change. The graph moves further after the sail as the regatta goes on. So the extreme speed we saw from Christensen in those first four races. Question, has he still got that magic speed? And then in the first four races, I thought Ainsley was a little bit off the pace, a bit slow. But when he came back from the rest day, I would almost guarantee he changed some equipment. Was it the mast? Was it the sail? I think it was the sail. Since then, he has just got better and better. The other thing to throw on the mix is the wind conditions. In the stronger winds, the Dane is heavier. He's big, he's 102 kilos. Ainsley at just over 90 kilos, so in the lighter conditions, you just put that pendulum a little bit back toward Ainsley. So as the race unfolds, I think we should be just trying to evaluate all those various aspects.
Very, very good point, Peter. And you can see that there are cameras on board every single one of these fins, so we're going to get some onboard action as well. And we have been really treated to some great stuff here.
Yeah, and now I think tactically we should be all over what's happening here. Will Ainsley, in fact, match race Christensen? Because if there can be a foul, and Ainsley looks, and there's a lot of action going on as we come up to 2 minutes. And if there is any hunting or any match racing going to... Yes, he is. So the game has already started between Christensen and Ainsley. Is this going to be a repeat of Sydney 2000, where Ainsley really sailed Robert Scheidt off the course? So Ainsley, a great match racer, and he's using all his match racing skills here against Christensen with 1:35 to go. Effectively, John, this race has already started. The battle has begun for the gold.
Well, the other thing to put in the mix here is that Pieter Jan Postma, you can't ignore him from the Netherlands. He is not that far behind the pace. In fact, we're only talking 14 points difference between Ainsley and Postma. So, could we get a repeat at the start where
you
he
could.
Sneaks up?
Well, you could. That's seventh. So that means if Postma wins the race, Ainsley has to be within the top seven. But for sure, Ben Ainsley is into match racing mode. As we're into the last minute before the start, Christensen will need to be very careful. It's all on between Denmark and GBR.
He's using
these
the
boat. These are classic match race moves by Ainsley as he tries to hunt down the Dane.
It's dodgeball.
And 40 seconds. Now that Christensen needs to be careful here as the windward boat, Ainsley is the leeward boat, can attack. As they come down, Ainsley now just tracking right behind Christensen. This is probably one of the most dangerous periods of the race for the Dane.
And look at the jury
behind. The jury are there. They are certainly paying attention. So Ainsley peels off to windward.
10
Posmar,
seconds.
Posmar's right in there as well. So Ainsley comes back right now. It is the Dane who is bow fired. Now back comes Ainsley in the windward position.
2-1. There we
go. Both boats behind the line. It's a clean start. And we saw match racing action in the pre-start between the Dane and the GBR. Well, as we expected, this one, it could be very interesting. Initial advantage off the line would go, if we're considering between Christensen and Ainsley, would be with the with Christensen, he's more bow forward. Posmar takes away. Well,
okay. Let us just explain to the viewers at the moment that the reason why Ben Ainsley is there, just tracking down, hunting down the Christensen, the Dane, is that if he beats the Dane and he doesn't come lower than seventh, then Ainsley will win it. Although he's 2 points behind at the moment. But he's the first attack. He's on the port tack and he's moving away now.
Forced attack away there. He was being affected by the wind shadow coming off Christensen's mainsail. So off the line, even with Ainsley's aggression, Jonas Herr Christensen actually got the better of the start. Now let this develop. Who is faster in these light to moderate conditions? The next aspect is also what side of the course is favoured. From earlier, earlier in the regatta, it has appeared as though the left-hand side has been favoured, especially in the top of the course, as Christensen tacks. Ainsley is in pretty well middle of the fleet. Christensen tacks. Looks like Bergmark also tacked underneath. So
let me just tell you here, Peter, interrupt. If it stays like that, second and tenth, it is the Dutch guy that comes in through.
Well, yeah, early on, this won't develop. It is Spain also coming off from that little inside. But I think initially it's Ben Ainsley and Christensen. We'll just keep a good monitoring eye on Posmar. John, you're a great stats man. You can, I'll put you in charge of the numbers. But we won't worry until the last third of the race, honestly, because it probably is a wee bit academic. Initially, for Ainsley to get up to gold, he's got to beat the Dane.
When we were watching him training, you mentioned about the mast. You think, obviously this is the Dane now, this is Christensen, but back on Ainsley's boat, you said that you think he's probably changed his mast.
Possibly the mast. Definitely, I think it's a different sail. With the regatta, as the regatta goes on over a week, the sails actually do deteriorate, with especially in heavy winds. Big split, boy, this is a lot of leverage that Christensen's giving Ainsley. See that Ainsley can hike?
He's gone up.
Two things.
He got closer to win there, didn't he?
Two things, though, John, is that Christensen, is there more wind on the right-hand side where Ainsley is right now? Possibly. But also, Ainsley is around 10 kilos lighter in body weight than Christensen. But tactically, it has paid to be on this left-hand side. I think the first cross, when they come back together, will be fascinating. And this could be it coming. Ainsley now has tacked. He's coming across on starboard.
But again, Peter Jan Posmar looks like he's ahead.
Ainsley's ahead. Look, it's the Dane. Christensen is quiet. Ainsley has picked a beautiful wake. Christensen's bailing out. Ainsley ahead of Christensen. looked at Ainslie C over on that right-hand side. Local knowledge.
Well, he went well there. In fact, in the early...
He's loving these conditions. Yeah. In the lighter conditions, Ainslie, you can see he can power the boat up easier. He can hike. Postma. So in the lead, we've got Netherlands, New Zealand, France, Croatia, Finland, Spain, Denmark, Germany, right back in eighth. What's that? 16 points. Yeah. So that means Postma. Well, Postma's got to win, though. Postma is not winning the race.
It's very tight, though, even now. Although we're looking at this angle, the camera condenses
it,
everything.
It does,
of course,
it does.
And you've got different shapes, different angles. The most important thing is that ley line, ultimately, on the boy.
It is. But for sure, Ben Ainslie saw something that he liked over on the right. And we can see, if we look, fifth boat down, the Union Jack. That's Ben Ainslie ahead of Christensen. Postma tacks into windward position, currently in third. Surely you can't get a replay of that wonderful start.
It's not impossible. I mean,
no, it's not impossible. But what it would take is for Postma to win the race. Then we would have another permutation.
We are going
Ainslie's
up.
Quick. Yeah. Ainslie is fast. I can tell you that.
He is, but let me tell you also that traditionally he much prefers the downstab. Oh, look at this, the first cross. That is so, so tight.
So the way they're currently stacked up, we would have Ainslie in winning overall. Not winning the race, winning overall. Then it would be back to Denmark and then to Postma from the Netherlands. Ben Ainslie, as long as he keeps really ahead of Denmark and within a boat length or one or two boats of the Netherlands, it really plays in the hands.
Yeah, you know that the guy that was really showing in the early rounds was Ivan Gaspik, and it looks like Gaspik has got the lead at the moment. Here's the first mark. There is Gaspik on the mark. The French guy coming as well, but this is fantastic.
Port starboard, Gaspik. Tax the leeward, right on the mark. Up goes the flag. There's a protest there from the French sailor. Lebeur, I saw a flag. Yep. As Dan Slater is certainly in the mix. He'll be enjoying Finland and GBR Netherlands. So it is Ben Ainslie right now. He's playing the game.
And this is his strength now, downwind.
Downwind. Yep. Now, have they got the pumping flag out? Yes, they have. You can just tell by the violent action. So Christensen is back.
He made a mistake going too long on that.
Well, he didn't. He basically didn't cover. He got it. He got the better of the start over Ainslie. But John, I just looking at the boats, I think Ainslie in these light conditions is faster on the upwind. And we know on the downwind with this very acrobatic pumping, rocking, balancing action that Ainslie has got. He is regarded as the best in the business downwind.
It's very physical, and he had a back operation not long ago, so this will be, you know, either glory or disaster for Ben Ainslie. There's nothing in between here, but look at him go. The onboard camera giving us fantastic shots of the effort that Ainslie is making. You talked about the greatest sailor of his era, maybe of all time.
Of all time, yeah. In Olympic disciplines. Yeah. And that really is what we're talking about, Ben Ainslie. Certainly
he's made up three gold medals already
in the draw, and he's right there. He's ahead of Denmark, and that's where he's got to be. He must beat Ben Ainslie, the Dane. Christensen 2 points ahead going in. If Ainslie beats Christensen by one place, then they are tied on points. The tiebreaker is, in fact, the medal race.
Yeah.
Ivan Gaspik.
Gaspik's doing well here at the moment, but there was the French protest. Tell us a little bit about the ramifications.
That was, ramifications, top mark, port starboard, and Gaspik came in on port. The boat required to keep clear, and we saw the French come in on starboard.
What are the penalties then?
Well, the penalty would be a turn. And it's on the water umpiring. I would assume, because there's been no penalty turn, that it was green flag, and that would be.
Did he do his turn there? Because he dropped immediately back, and it didn't seem.
No, but he's further to leeward. I didn't see any turn, but I didn't see a flag.
This is extraordinary.
Look at Ben Ainslie. Look at the style of this guy. Standing up and they rock, and as they rock, they just use the wave. And as the sail and the boom accelerate, they put a bit of pressure on the main sheet. They give it a pull, and it's just like rowing the boat down the waves.
He is going past a crowd that is cheering him as if he was Ennis or Mo Farah at the stadium. Oh, it is wonderful. Quite an extraordinary atmosphere. He's being cheered all the way by the home crowd.
Well, there's been huge expectation on Ben Ainslie as the French
just look jibe. Working hard for his life here, Ben Ainslie, and going down to the leeward mark.
I see the umpires right alongside the jury, but for Ben Ainslie, the rule for the Finns is they do have this option of really making it open slather for the downwind.
For guys who don't realise, that was an extraordinary move, as it looks like he's buying here between France and Great Britain, but the jibe. Okay, the wind is not that big, but in order to balance the boat like it's that, you've got to be
but it's superb. But it's the technique. He stands up, he rocks the boat to leeward, pulls the boat back over on top, and as the boom accelerates, he just pumps the sail, and it's
so that... no kicking strap on that.
Very little kicker on, and the centreboard's quite high. So coming into Mark Two, and it's Ainslie with incredible downwind speed. He's going to lead at Mark Two. Jonathan Lobart, who led at the top mark, but it's all Ben Ainslie. John, he is not quite there, but there is a split.
Just coming out onto this left buoy, and well, he's obviously decided that he's in great shape at the moment. Just look at the crowd here cheering him on. I've never known such passion in Weymouth. You know, the West Country boys and girls are all quite nice and easygoing people, but at the moment, they are just absolutely loving this. Huge passion.
We're at Mark Two as we look. There's Dan Slater coming round from New Zealand. Christensen back in the pack. He's not enjoying the rider conditions. Robert Ainslie, Kasper Postma.
Oh, the Dean is nowhere near
He's, to be honest, he's off the pace. And Ainslie, just being of lighter body weight, is 10 kilos lighter. So what does that mean? It means that he powers up quicker. The boat will feel more dynamic earlier than the heavier helmsman. And, of course, on the downwind, it means you're carrying effectively of a bag of coal less in the back of the boat. Lighter weight, you go faster.
And the wind is the friend of Ainslie right here at the moment. If Christensen had a little bit more of a blow, you'd see it differently. We've got, obviously, the cameras there. We've got GBR and Denmark, but the windward boat, GBR, really, really significantly higher up the course.
There is, but Ben Ainslie has put the cover on Christensen. He'll be watchful of Postmar, of course, but really the first priority, he's got to beat the Dane over the line.
There's a significant, although this camera angle here is magnificent, there is a significant difference, several hundred meters to the shoreline. It looked as if they were getting very, very close, not at all in reality.
So Jonas Ho Christensen went in after into the medal race in first position on 26 points. 2 points ahead of Ben Ainslie, but in the medal race, double point scoring, it is Ainslie ahead of Christensen. The other third place we've got to consider will be Pieter Postma.
Yeah.
And really, that's a watching brief.
So, Croatia, it looked as if they might have taken something there, but I'm sure, traditionally, Ainslie has a few more problems upwind than he does.
Yeah, but not in this condition. This is right. And I think he's close to being the fastest upwind in this. It's got a bit lighter. I'd say it's only 12 knots now. But it's noticeable that Ainslie is nearly full stack, full height. And Christensen is not. There's Finland coming through.
That's very interesting,
that down to body weight and also rig setup. 10 kilos is a lot. So you pay a price in the light if you're heavy, but if the breeze is on, like it was earlier in the week when Christensen was so dominant.
Yeah, 20 knots.
He had the boat speed on Ainsley.
That was fantastic. Just look at the air, the atmosphere. It's just beautiful here at Weymouth and Portland. The nose is the course.
We're coming up to the halfway point. And just looking at your figures there, John, I think right now it would be Ainsley from Christensen and then Posmar would make up the top three. Depending what happens as this one unfolds, but Ainsley really is just making sure that he gets ahead of Christensen. That's the first priority.
Again, everything is condensed here with these long, long lens cameras. It's quite remarkable what we can achieve, and absolutely brilliant. And you're part of it. It's coming to your living rooms at home. It is a magnificent view here.
Here's the ley line to the top mark. They're just below the ley line. That's the yellow marker. That's just to give us the animated look. But Ainsley directly in front of Christensen.
And you can't read too much into that particular graphic at the moment until we see the mark.
Jonathan Loberg. Again, they will let him live. Not too concerned. I mean, it's certainly a great thing if Frenchman can get up and win. He's in fourth position at the moment, but really it's game on between these two, between Ainsley and Christensen. Christensen, see, he's getting gassed. He was in the wake of Ainsley. And the rule of thumb, there's wind shadowing effect. 10 mast heights is how far back that wind shadow will extend.
Wow.
So Christensen now tacks, goes out to windward. We call that thin on the hip, thin on the right-hand side of Ainsley. But Ainsley, the boat always looks a little bit more powered up to me, a little bit more heel on. Christensen looks a little bit dead. The boat doesn't quite look as lively as this group that have been really let go to the left-hand side. We've been concentrating on Ainsley a lot. The left-hand side of this course is paying, so Ainsley has dropped back in the fleet, but he's ahead of Christensen, and that's what he's concentrated on. So France in the lead at mark three.
That's Jonathan Loubert.
Loubert comes round the mark. Comfortable lead. He's in fourth position, leading into the medal race. The one I'm looking out for is Netherlands, because that could also have an effect. There's Dan Slater from New Zealand. He is having a good medal race, so he's going to be in there second. Sweden coming underneath. So New Zealand second, Sweden. Ainsley's just match racing.
Yep. Looks like it. He's just checked out the opposition.
It's pretty reminiscent, actually.
It is.
I was lucky enough to see. Yeah, Posma's back as well. So, again, it's pretty safe for Ainsley, and that's why...
There he is. Posma right there on the mark.
But it's safe. It's only two or three boats ahead. So Ainsley at mark three. Yeah, just over halfway through the race.
Posma just turns there.
Posma,
he's in third
Ainsley,
place. Yeah.
Just two places there that equates to 4 points. And as long as Posmar is back, Ainsley will just camp on Christensen. So Ainsley's playing with...
Taking some finish
well,
there.
What he's doing is just saying, I'm better to just stick close to Christensen. Don't give him any leverage. He must win. He's got to be in front of Christensen. They've worked their way to the back of the field.
Yeah, amazing, isn't it?
The last, the second to last. But that is because in terms of the tactic, the Posmar is also back. Loubert in the lead. I bet he's looking behind going, what on earth is going on here?
Well,
he's figured it out.
Well,
actually,
wait a minute then. Let's just have a look at this. Jonathan Loubert is 47 points net. He threw away his 10th place in the 8th race. So 47 plus 2 is 49. Now, let's have a look at where Ben Ainsley is at the moment, and he is on 28 points. This is going to be another one similar to the start. So I tell you, John's, this is extraordinary.
John's doing the maths. Maybe you can just spend a little bit of time on that. If, if Laubert wins, where does Ainsley have to get?
Well, in fact, it's 49 points Laubert, but even if they go back ninth place, that's 18 onto that, it's still okay.
Yeah, so
just about.
And Ainsley,
he knows that.
He would have had that all worked out, I'm sure, between himself and his coach, David Howlett. David Howlett, a legend coach here in the UK, Ben Ainsley's mentor coach. They would have figured all those permutations out. So Ainsley to Leward. But the most important thing is ahead of Christensen, so he's in control.
He is in the moment, and Postma is not that far ahead.
And Postma, where it would have been interesting if Postma had actually been further up the pack, but he's not. So Postma is one of the keys to the door if this game is going to break open. But Ainsley,
not much action here. The wind has dropped a bit.
Now, I would say, looking at the boats, the umpires have decided no pumping on this downwind wind. We saw on the first downwind, there was lots of pumping action. And Ainsley literally rode himself down into second place. See how quiet they are now? Now, that's played in the hands of Christensen, because Ainsley is a better technician when, you know, when the flag is displayed for pumping. So there's lots of games within the game being played here. It looks quiet and tranquil as they head down towards the bottom mark, but Ainsley just jibing ahead. But for sure, now the Finns are under the same racing conditions in terms of downwind kinetics as everyone else in the game. Rule 42 applies. So we're into Mark 4. Jonathan Laubert leading. He's in fourth place.
He won't move from that, I don't think.
Well, will he? Because I'm just thinking for bronze. Well, that will. Bronze, he is on 47. Postma's on 42. So that will bring Laubert up to third, in my reckoning. Get your calculator out again, John, while I concentrate.
I will. Where is Postma?
Postma is back 7th or 8th.
Yeah, well, that could change it. That will definitely
Next,
change.
We've got Dan Slater. Next, we have Croatia.
It's Gaspik, Ivan Gaspik.
And we're looking out now
protest.
For Postma.
Oh, he's way back.
He's back. So, then we've got Ainsley and Christensen who trail a fleet, but they pretty well have the game in hand. Or Ben Ainsley does. He's controlling the game at the moment. But really, as we go round Mark 4, we start to think about who's lining up for the bronze medal.
At the moment, I got a feeling that Jonathan Laubert will take that, because the
Well, as we go round Mark 4, the way I see it is Ainsley is leading, Christensen is second, and Laubert is third.
Definitely, that is the way
so
it is.
So, we'll just try and keep that in mind. We're on the final windward beat. We go up around the top mark and then down to the finish.
We really do need the graphic to confirm, because, you know, particularly when you've got a mark you can go either side, it's very difficult to establish. But the windward side is GBR's Ben Ainsley. And of course, he's been, every time he's won big, he's been awarded some honours. It was OBE after 2001, the New Year's honours. He was OBE, MBE after 2001, OBE after Sydney winning, and CBE. So every time he's won and been voted as the top performer, he's won an accolade.
So,
Sir Ben for you from now on.
I was just going to ask. Do you think he'd get a gong if he won this? Become the greatest Olympic sailor
ever? He'll be knighted. Definitely.
Finally deserved if it happens.
It is a magnificent picture. GBR, the Union flag there, the Danes, the most decorated in terms of their Olympic achievements is sailing.
John, this is changing again. It's a changing game. There's a little bit more pressure down to Leward. And now it's Christensen who's getting a little bit of a push around the nose. Ben Ainslie keeping in touch, but just look at the bearing change. Christensen has got a little bit more angle than Ainslie. Ainslie's being sailed around here. Christensen is in a bit of pressure. It is just now the game on again. Ainslie tacked away. I would say Ainslie feels as though Christensen has got up to bout about or better.
Wow, this is unbelievable stuff.
Surely we're not going to see another one after watching that star race where the blood pressure went through the roof. It's on again.
You said the pressure on the nose for Christensen is more of a punch on the nose for Ainslie.
he's a poet.
We've almost forgotten about him.
I haven't. I've got him in bronze.
He's bronze.
We've got a monitor where. So for. He's. I've got Lobier 5 points behind Posmar, which equates to three places.
Yeah, now he's.
If it's three places between Lobier and Posmar, he will get the bronze medal. So we'll just monitor that. We've been concentrating on the. Really, the absolute fascinating race between Ainslie and Christensen. Ainslie looked to be in control, but as they went up along the nose, there was a difference in pressure.
Well, that will be.
We'll have to wait. We'll wait for them to come back together. We're back to the front. There's Dan Slater from New Zealand. Had a bit of an up and down week, actually, as we look at Dan. Too many high scores in the teams.
7-11. He did win a race three, but. For 17 discard and then a 15 difficult.
I can't wait to see where the Christensen and where are they. The animation is. Look at this, John. They might be telling us something.
You never know.
Has Christensen got back into the game? There he is. He looks quiet. Look at a current running.
Yeah.
See the left to right action?
Yeah.
That's current.
It's a falling tide.
Ebbing tide, as they say here in the UK. Christensen. So, is the current going to come into play? Where is
Ainslie's
come right out
animation,
into the middle.
Animation reads him at 8.
Boy, there's a lot of separation. It only takes one boat to get a little more pressure.
Ah, this is interesting. Look at the France boat at 1, Netherlands at 4, according to the animation. Now
still
work
not,
it out.
Still not enough. Three places for... Lobier leads. It's quite light and fluky at the top. For Ben Ainslie, at the top of the course, I think there generally is a bit of a left-hand push. It looked earlier on as though Christensen right in on the nose was getting a nice angle.
I think he's good here. It just looks comfortable. He's not that anxious at the moment. But the big smile is on the face.
Yes, no, you're right. Look the bearing. Just look at the bearing. If that rubber boat would get out of the way. So the trick here is, Ainslie's ahead. See how he's gaining distance on Christensen. The magnifying effect of the camera. So back of the pack, it's Ainslie, Christensen. Nothing in it. Absolutely nothing in it.
With one more leg.
Well, no, just the run to the finish. Yeah. Up around the top mark, down to the finish. So at mark 5, it is Lobier from France. Daniel Slater from New Zealand. Lobier currently, there's Netherlands in there.
Yeah.
Postmar. So he now, Postmar is back into third.
Yeah,
with
that puts him in bronze.
That puts him back into bronze. So that was a brilliant upwind by Postmar to get back into bronze. So as they currently stand at the top mark, they're on the run to finish. It'll be Ainslie, Postmar, Christensen will make up. Gold, silver, and bronze.
It is fascinating, this, because Posmar, he obviously has done a great job in getting back into this one, because the leader at the moment, the Frenchman, Jonathan Lobert, was definitely the favourite to take the bronze, but he spent a lot of time in Australia as Peter Jan Posmar, and with Tom Slings being a whole bunch of others who are really, really good. And you made the point to me earlier that a lot of these sailors come from the colder regions, and I love to...
Absolutely. I think this regatta here in Weymouth, we're seeing the emergence of really sailors that have come from the colder countries. And out of that top 10, we've only got the Trujillo, who's the only sailor from the Mediterranean.
And he's back in 10th place.
He's back in 10th spot. So, yeah, that's something else to throw into the mix.
Are we going to start celebrating here if you have any allegiance with Britain?
Well, it won't be for Laubert. You better get that tear out of your eye. I can see it swelling, John. No, I think it will be an unbelievable achievement by Ben Ainslie if he takes this gold medal.
France in the lead at one, and Netherlands have come up to third place. They may even get up to second looking at that.
That's a good comeback. We've been concentrating a lot on Ainslie and Christensen. Look, the way Postma was in trouble, and really he hung it out on the seaward side, on the right-hand side on that upwind.
And I think he's got up to bronze medal place, and he has a chance really to confirm that. He's got Dan Slater in his sights there, just to the left of him, just the leeward side of him. And here we go. This is what it's all about. The gold is in sight for Great Britain's Ben Ainslie. And just look there at Hock Christensen with a little heave. But it's 38 metres the difference here as they come down towards the finish. And there's no doubt at all, there will be a huge number of people around the world, all the sailors looking at this and saying, Ben Ainslie, unbelievable. Started out this series in really, under par form. Hock Christensen, absolutely unbelievable, flying out from the start. But now it's all come down to this final medal race, 2 points the difference. And if Ben Ainslie can keep it as it is, because of the medal rules, he takes the gold.
Well, for, I've just done a quick calculation while you were going there. Postma, really, 8 points, or 8 places, should I say, yeah, between him and Ainslie, if he was going to get up into goal. But Postma,
he's in third,
so that's not enough. So Ben Ainslie really, Ben Ainslie has just let Postma sail his race, and he has worked the maths perfectly here against Christensen.
Would you, if you've been sailing in Ben Ainslie's shoes, would you have done exactly what he did there?
Well,
very difficult. I know
he's the expert, and I think between Ainslie and his coach David Howlett, they've worked this one out. They would have done all their permutations. And Jonas Christensen, I think he knows this is silver. And after,
well, I mean, just look at the sheet here. I've got the after 10 races, it's all unbelievable. First two, and then a second. One, two. I mean, he was just, yeah, up until race six, he was absolutely the favourite.
Well, in the 10 races, he beat Ben Ainslie 3 times. But the times that he didn't beat Ainslie, he was back. And remember, it's a low point scoring system.
And he's gone out from 28 to 54 metres now. And Britain's Ben Ainslie, well, the superlatives will start ringing around the world. There's no doubt at all about that. New Zealand really pushing hard, and not too far behind is Peter Jan Postma. And in fact, it looks like they might be really, really on a clash here. Very, very close. Postma, did they touch?
Postma, there was on the charge to the finish. Now, if Postma can get round, Slater, Ben Ainslie has to be a bit careful.
Yep.
So Daniel Slater has a big role to play. The first boat is halfway down the reach, onto the finishing line, but it's all on in the group behind. So Laubert is going to win the medal race here in the Finn class. But it's behind that the action is breaking loose, so it's Laubert. It's going to win the race, but he's not going to win the battle. It looked like Ben Ainslie has the regatta in hand, but it was Postma who was putting Slater under the attack.
Here's the line, and the Frenchman, Jonathan Laubert, will take line honours, but I think he will place in the agonising position of fourth overall, but it's still to be unfolded. Finish there for Laubert. There was a protest by him against the Croatian. That was earlier against Gaspic. We'll see whether or not that happens, but all the action right behind him.
Yeah, we want to pick it up, but New Zealand, they're ahead. Danny Slater is ahead, and Slater will come over the line second, and then there's a gaggle of boats. So it's Slater, Spain, and look at the line, look at the angle between Ainslie as he comes in, Croatia, Netherlands, Sweden. There's Slovenia. Where are Ainsley and Christensen? It looks to me the Union Jack's flying.
They know.
I think they know that Ben Ainsley has got this one on the bag. Here comes Ben Ainsley. Ben Ainsley comes over the line. Ben Ainsley, Olympic champion.
Absolutely superb from Ainsley. It was a match race in the end against the Dane. Hock Christensen, what a battle, what a regatta. And hands together for this man, Hock Christensen. What an extraordinary week he's had as well. Huge disappointment at the end, but celebration here in Britain, in Weymouth and Portland. Just look at it, what it means. This is a sailing crowd. They are absolutely loving it. Ainsley, the best sailor, what we say, of all time.
Well, in Olympic classes, Ben Ainsley, 4 gold medals consecutively. He won his first gold medal in 2000 in Sydney in the laser class. The second gold medal came 4 years later in Athens in the Finn. And then in 2008 in Beijing in Qingdao, Ben Ainsley, 3rd gold medal. And now we see the 4th gold medal to Ben Ainsley here in Weymouth. The greatest sailor, the Olympic sailor we've ever seen, superseding the great Paul Elvstrøm. And for Jonas Christensen from Denmark, well, well, well.
That is the biggest disappointment, not just that he's picked up the silver,
David Howlett,
the gold.
David Howlett, the mentor, the coach of Ben Ainsley.
But I think the biggest problem for Hock Christensen is he tried desperately to defend that record of Elvstrøm.
Very, very gut-wrenching. Ben Ainsley, and it will be all over, I'm sure, the media here in Britain. But it's a world story, an unbelievable story that someone, well.
An afternoon sail out in Weymouth, Portland. No,
John,
I've got a silver.
But John, not to be disgraced.
No.
This man had set this regatta alight on that first day.
Superb, absolutely
magnificent. And I think when he gets over the initial shot, Jonas Christensen, a very proud competitor, and it's no disgrace to be beaten by the greatest sailor that Olympic riding has ever seen, Ben Ainsley. 4 gold medals.
Extraordinary. After the
extraordinary is, yeah. I think that's an understatement.
The best
4 golds to Ben. I'm just trying to pick out if I can see any of the other GBR sailors. I'm sure if they are not competing, they're on the clenched fist is raised for Ben Ainsley.
There's one other issue that we haven't actually resolved yet. Did Postma get up? Did he get up? This is a replay of the finish, and Ainsley obviously celebrating hugely there. But Jonathan Laubert won it, and we didn't quite pick Postma on the line. That's the agony of defeat. The ecstasy of victory and the agony of defeat right there. Second on is, in fact, he never got better than second until this medal race.
Unbelievable. That's right. And I mean, what a time to get into the lead. Here's one of the ribs that gives us the great shots. Ben Ainsley. What a record. 4 gold medals and a silver.
I think he's shaking his head as well. He can't believe it. Absolutely fantastic. It's fantastic for the individual, but can you imagine what it does for the country and for the sport of sailing?
Well, and that's where I come from. You really need true icons, role models, and Ben Ainsley, I mean, obviously for the local crowd, second overall, Jonas Hoe Christensen. Ben Ainsley becomes, I think, a wonderful role model
ambassador
for Olympic sailing. And I mean, as a kid, I can remember reading books about the wonderful sailor Paul Elvstrøm. Yeah. And Ben Ainsley now, for any young sportsman, if you're sailing, you become really a mentor, an icon, someone to aspire to.
So you really do mean Sir Ben, don't you?
Will it happen?
I tell you what, there'll be a few people that will expect it to happen. Jonathan Laubert wins the race, the medal race. Dan Slater from New Zealand in second. VR, who was up in 10th, well, he didn't he put a great sail together there, but it's all about this man, the 35-year-old. He did all his sailing down in Cornwall, in Falmouth. He considers this his home course as well. He read it brilliantly, the tactics are right on, and here is the overall result. Ainsley 46, Jonas Hogg Christensen at 46, and it was Lobert, and that was the question I was asking earlier.
Lobert has got up to take the bronze.